anything you think about recreational shark fishing and toss it over the side. Anglers at this research-driven sporting event compete against each other without boats. To earn points, they'll need to safely catch, measure, photograph, and research tag all qualifying sharks before releasing them back to the wild. Land-based shark fishing in the Blacktip Challenge? Ha ha! It's like nothing you've ever seen.
This is a project we got involved with after its founder and director, Josh Jorgensen, called to ask if we'd be interested in filming and producing it.
It was 8 crazy days of 24/7 shark fishing covering 70 miles of coastline and several dozen anglers.
It was intentionally planned to take advantage of the winter blacktip shark migration along Florida's east coast. As far as we're concerned, the more sharks, the better.
We made this unique by working with Josh and our friends at the National Marine Fisheries Service on a format that would require the complete documentation and tagging of all qualifying sharks.
It would be the first organized land-based shark fishing event to combine all these elements. For us as anglers, it's one of our favorite styles of fishing because it provides for a very up-close and personal interaction experience with these animals, which also allows us to take precise measurements that can be used to calculate a reliable estimated weight for these fish, further adding to the important scientific contribution of these anglers.
This is something we helped popularize nearly a decade ago, and we're happy to see it catching on over the years. Strangely enough, before that, a lot of anglers were underestimating the weight of their fish.
We worked very closely with them for over a week, sometimes too close. As a matter of fact, on Friday the 13th, I got to literally jump the shark.
Since this was something completely new, we geared up to shoot the action in a way that would also make the viewers feel like they were part of it.
This sport is special to us, and this was a great opportunity to spotlight some of our fellow anglers.
It was one heck of a week. We had some bad weather the first few days, but in the end, we captured a lot of action and tagged a lot of sharks, including a world record blacktip.
We look forward to sharing more of those stories. For now, enjoy this preview of the Blacktip Challenge.
Just as surely as autumn surrenders to winter, Florida's coastline attracts more than just sun and surf worshiping tourists. Every year, between November and April, just off the beaches in the chilled waters of the Atlantic Ocean, impressive numbers of blacktip sharks arrive here too. At times, forming migratory schools numbered in the hundreds. It's a perennial headline news story about hordes of invading sharks, but these fish are simply following an instinctive and ancient path of survival, ingrained through millions of years of perfected evolution. In 2009, a cooperative effort between recreational anglers and the marine research and conservation communities was set in motion to briefly intercept these animals in an attempt to learn more about them and ultimately to make valuable scientific contributions to their long-term sustainability. By leveraging a fishing tournament format to attract some of the angling world's best talent, along with the implementation of innovative guidelines for the safe capture, documentation, and release of migrating sharks, much could be learned through the combined goals of sport and science. For this blacktip challenge, conventional hook and line gear will be used to catch the sharks. But you can take what most might consider traditional fishing methods and toss those over the side. That's because blacktips, and many other shark species for that matter, can be found directly in the surf zone of many of the world's beaches. And that's exactly why these anglers will employ a specialized technique called land-based shark fishing. As the name indicates, no boats or long-range offshore rides to the middle of nowhere, typically associated with shark fishing, will be utilized in this endeavor. The technique, and ultimately the sport of land-based shark fishing, was born from the practical thinking of cash-strapped, big-game anglers in the early parts of the 20th century. By then, tales of high seas adventure and epic battles with sea monsters, touted by the likes of Zane Grey and Ernest Hemingway, popularized this new recreational activity that came to be known as deep-sea fishing. However, this pursuit also came with a price tag that not every angler could afford. But that didn't stop adventure-seeking sportsmen from figuring out ways to target, fight, and land large fish on a limited budget from the confines of the beach and other attached structures, such as jetties, piers, bridges, and even oil platforms. If deep-sea fishing was a bit unconventional in its early days, land-based shark fishing was, and still remains, among the world's most extreme angling quests. It's no small wonder, then, that the sport attracts a very unique breed of angler. Inspired by the sport's pioneers, these shark fishing specialists are an engaging fusion of hunter, adventurer, and outspoken steward of the marine environment who will typically tell you it's the ones who spend the most time enjoying what's out there who also do the most to protect and conserve what's out there. So the stage is set as several dozen hardcore big game anglers, armed with their knowledge and experience, some trusted old tools of the trade, and a few new ones, will square off in an all-out push to not only capture, but also measure, photograph, research tag, and release as many sharks as they can in 8 days off Florida's East Coast. Sounds simple enough, but Mother Nature and Lady Luck have their own set of plans for those taking on this Blacktip Challenge.
Well, here we are. It's the 2009 Blacktip Challenge Land-Based Shark Fishing Tournament. We're very happy to have Pat Turner with the National Marine Fisheries Service and the tournament director and founder, Josh Jorgensen. Josh, maybe you just give us just a brief rundown on the rules. What are the requirements for a fish to qualify for points in this tournament?
Basically, the anglers will have to, they will be given 10 tags, and they will have to tag 10 sharks. The first 10 sharks, they will have to be tagged. And after that, they can catch and release. And all the sharks that are tagged, they have to be measured fork length, girth, and overall length. And they will be submitted back to know all the information. And basically, anglers will be competing for largest shark, most sharks, and largest black tip. We will also have divisions for female anglers and for junior anglers. And there will also be prizes for recapture tags and other stuff like that.
As far as tournament fishing goes, any time that recreational anglers can take these opportunistic steps to provide this data to National Marine Fisheries Service, just tell us a little bit about what that's used for from the scientific side.
Yeah, well, it's a good predictor. First of all, the tagging itself is a very good way to keep track of the migrations of the sharks on the coast, and also we can use it to assess how many sharks are in an area at a given time.
So population studies, things like that, give you an idea if they're increasing, decreasing. Josh, back to your point, I'm going to actually hand this over to Pat. The measurements that the anglers are taking during the tournament are very important for you getting an estimated weight, is that correct?
That's correct. Because you're tagging the sharks on the land, you don't really have a good way to weigh a shark. So you can use the fork length as a very good predictor of the weight.
So the fork being the caudal fin, the tail that forms a little V there, it's right there in the center of the upper and the lower tail, forward, and then the girth. So they use a formula, and I believe that's fairly accurate enough that we can get a really good idea of the size of these fish. We're really excited, my brother and I, Brooks, to be a part of this tournament, and the very important aspect of a recreational shark fishing tournament that we're proud of here is the introduction of tagging as a requirement in the tournament. Yeah.
So we can use this tag. They're on pre-numbered cards that match the number on the tag. And once someone tags the shark, they can fill out all this information here. And it's postpaid and can come back to us.
These are a new style of tag designed for sharks that live a shorter life.
That's correct. The tag, just put it on the end of the tagging needle right here. Carefully. And you just want to get it into the big muscle that's right by the dorsal fin of the shark. Right there.
Right in the meat of the back.
Yep.
Thank you guys very much for the time. Once again, we're really excited to be a part of this, and I think everybody else is too. We look forward to a great week of fishing and a little bit of science and fun all mixed together, right?
Yep.
Okay,
Here we are at the Blacktip Challenge 2009. This is what you would call the kickoff party here, basically. It's the anglers meeting, and I'm here with Chris Bishop from Team Black Bart. You're headquartered out of?
Juneau.
Well, we're right here in his backyard in Juneau. Wonderful sunny Florida, not right now because it's a little late in the day. But nonetheless, just tell us a little bit about what you're hoping to accomplish this week. Are you going for biggest fish, most fish? What's your plan?
I don't know. It's going to be a big hammer that's going to win this tournament. So I think everybody's shooting for a big hammer. So.
We were recording when he said that, right? Big hammer. How big do you think?
Somewhere around 12 or 13 will win the tournament.
Well, that'd be a fantastic fish. Now, I've heard that there have been some sightings. Some big fish have been spotted, mixed in with the typical schools of black tips and spinners and smaller bulls at this time.
Yeah, there's been a couple here and there. We've seen a couple cruising the beach looking for cobia, so they're definitely out there. It's just getting a bait in front of one.
I think everybody here would probably agree that luck is important, but would you also say that luck is sort of like that place where preparation and opportunity come together?
Sure.
So I would say you're prepared.
Yeah.
And the opportunity is here, and a 12-foot hammerhead sounds really good. So listen, great luck.
Thanks.
We'll be watching you guys, and I'm hoping to hook up with you out there on the beach, my brother and I as well. So.
Sounds good.
Come on!
I'm here with fellow angler Will Fundora. Your plan for this tournament, first of all, it's great to have you, being a part of it, but what do you have in mind? What's your strategy?
It's not so much about winning, but participating and keeping the sport alive.
We've done some innovative things with this tournament format. In particular, we're introducing the tagging of sharks as a qualifying step. And you're a guy who's seen shark fishing, particularly land-based shark fishing, really evolve over a period of time. So you've seen a lot of changes with the fishery and so on and so forth. So what are your thoughts, regarding this sort of a trend that's taking place with catch and release?
Yeah, it's got to be the way it's going to go because of the shark populations have been depleted. Catch and release is a great thing, and tagging them is even better because we're helping out the scientific community to track the sharks and know their movements and lifespan.
That's really so important, bringing the recreational community together, the recreational angling community, and the scientific community. And our goal is to get 500 of these tags in these fish so that we can just perpetuate that scientific research.
It's a great thing. I'm hoping that every one of them will go out there.
It's going to be a lot of fun for us to do that.
We're grateful that you guys are out here doing this.
I'm looking forward to it.
And we're hoping to put a tag on a 14 and a half foot tiger shark. That would be a great
nice.
You know what?
There you
got
go.
My vote. All right, great, man. Good
Thank
luck.
You.
Now we're here with Team Rebel.
My name is Zach Miller. I'm 21 from Okeechobee, Florida.
All right, I'm Jeff Dillon, 25 years old, originally from California.
Patrick Clyde, 21, Palm Beach, Florida.
And how long have you guys been fishing together?
They've only been shark fishing with me for a short period of time. They're about round 5 of Team Rebel.
Is that right?
Oh, yeah.
Of at least a 13 rounder?
Oh, hell yeah.
Heavyweight slugfest?
Oh, we are here to slug it out.
Tell us a little bit about what you guys are looking forward to accomplishing here in the next week.
The only thing that Team Rebel looks to accomplish is big fish victory. That is the only thing that will be acceptable for us. So anything else is a failure.
Go big or go home.
Go big or go home. That's it.
Well, let us, the Paxton Brothers, be the first to say good luck. We expect nothing but great things from you guys. And we're going to look forward to being out
there
with you. Storming the beaches. And for us, it's going to be nice being spectators for change. We're always out there and cranking away to ourselves. This is going to be a lot of fun for us.
Sit back and relax, and hopefully we can put on a show for you.
Yeah, I know you guys will, man. We're looking forward to it. Awesome, man.
We're ready for it.
All right, 2009 Black Tip Challenge.
Welcome to the 2009 Blacktip Challenge, land-based shark fishing tournament. Let's hit the beaches and see who's fishing and who's catching.
You said you're gonna have a big shark by when?
3 o'clock.
3 o'clock?
3 o'clock. So give it one hour and 47 minutes, we'll have a big shark on.
Eastern Standard Time.
Eastern Standard Time.
Perfect.
We're here somewhere on the east coast of Florida. Give us a run down here and drop his baits.
Well, what we're going to do is we're going to tie a cinder block, a brick, or a rock with really thin mono to the loop of our rig, right at the wire. So that way when the shark bites it, it's going to cut right through it, it's going to drop the rock, and we just get the fish on. What I do is I put it on the back of that kayak, the rock and the bait. Keep the bait on the kayak as I go out so we don't lose a lot of juices on the way there. Once it feels, you know, when it's deep enough, say, after about 100, 200, 300 yards, drop it down deep enough, come right back and wait.
Like where it feels sharky.
Just about.
And then fight his way back to the surf, try not to dump it. We'll be back, hopefully without a dump.
Okay, well, basically, this is for big sharks, okay? An 18-ounce Pitman circ hook, okay? I use double up number 19 wire. I use American Fishing wire, Haywire twist. I twist it all the way up, and I use Haywire twist. I got a 500-pound swivel. Now, I use 500-pound mono, but I have about 6 feet of this, and then I put about 20 feet of mono. And when I attach it to my main swivel, I like to double it up and twist it, just in case one fails, you know? And, I mean, you want to use aluminum crimps for mono. It's good to use thimbles. Thimbles will prevent them off stretching when you got that little mount there, and will keep them in place.
My favorite spot to put the fish in right here.
That's the first part that breaks off, bro.
That ain't going anywhere. Yeah, you know, you're probably wondering with a bait this size, how do you keep it out there, you know? But here's how we do it. We get rocks, just a chunk of concrete, tie a uni knot to it. What I like to do, I mean, these guys do it differently, but I just like to tie a quick, simple uni knot to the eye of the hook. And what happens when the shark bites it, takes the bait, they'll bite this line off, the rock will break off just somewhere on the bait and eat it. That's what happens when things are made in China.
There's another one for the collection.
Well, the cone is saved in one shot.
Still works, right?
Well, I would say he was working under unusual circumstances. So that was a $400 bait drop.
Yeah, I know.
Between your Costa Del Mar and this.
Alright, take two.
High tide. We also have, you know, the waves, which you can tell are not small today. So it's kind of rough getting out there, but the way back was fun, you know, quick, easy, pretty clean, I mean, for the most part. There's tons of bait around. I mean, I got hit by this in the face just as on the way back. It's kind of weird, but it happened.
We'll chunk it back out. We'll recycle, though.
Yeah, we'll recycle.
So we'll be back for the Blacktip Challenge somewhere on the east coast of Florida.
Jeff, watch out. Little Stratic 8000. I use this reel for muskie fishing up north.
Sure. Keep barracuda. And
50-pound mono. shark. Oh my god. Yeah, it's a freaking shark. I saw the fin. Oh my god. Get the fuck through.
Going off in here?
Oh my god. Yeah. Oh my god. He's gotta be one of those denture sharks.
Jack. Man, there's no way a jack can pull this reel. How do you not like this?
Jack, ready?
Down here, man.
Down here?
Yeah, you can't pull in the leader, hey?
I'm gonna try to get him in. I mean, I can't guarantee this because it's only 50 pound mono.
That's a pompano or bluefish. I'm gonna try to pull him up.
Bait was this big.
Yeah.
Overall length, hey, let's do this, good. And the build is 31.
There we go. Finish card.
We want to get some underwater perspective.
All right.
So with the rough conditions that we have today, we're not going to go out too deep. We'll probably just be in about waist or chest deep water.
Yeah.
So when the time is right, you and I will coordinate verbally. When the fish is coming in close enough, I'll let you know I'm going in because I want to go behind the leader angle, okay? So he's going this way. I want to kind of come in from this angle and just follow him up to the
shadow
beach.
Him.
We're gonna have to go do something around these rocks, you know? I mean, we're gonna have to go to either the beach on the left or the right.
Okay, that's gonna sort of be up to the fish, right?
Probably not safe around the rocks.
So in other words, it'd be better if I can be maybe over here.
Well, I'll try to bring him over here.
Okay.
So.
Yeah, the shark will have some part in that decision, but you can turn his head, get him that way, and then what I'll do, wherever the angle is, the tightness on the leader, I'll just be behind that, and I'll just kind of follow him. And do your thing, handle your fish like you normally would, but you and I'll just have some eye contact on the angle of the leader. All right,
that's good. Yeah,
looking forward to that. I've had a chance to catch up with a few of the anglers. We're getting some reports from here and there about some fish being caught. A lot of non-qualifying fish under 60 inches, but we've had a few qualifiers. You've had a chance to talk to some anglers, and I know the weather's affected things. What have you been hearing?
I heard the one guys, they're fishing a little north of us. They got one on, but I talked to them like 4 hours ago. I mean, they could have had more than that now. You know, I hope everybody gets the sharks. I mean, sharks are here right now. I mean, They're hitting pieces of bait that big. You know, there are some guys, I think there's some Will and them are fishing down south. I don't know.
South Florida Shark Club team.
Yeah, I don't know what they're doing.
Yeah, we spoke with them yesterday and we're coordinating to tonight. We're probably going to we're gonna try to get back up here. I know you're gonna have a group of anglers fishing here, some of them competitors from the tournament. Brooks and I are planning to probably head south sometime close to sunset. We've got Zach and Team Rebel down there.
Yeah.
And those guys are notorious for putting some big fish up. So other than that, we're just going to keep roaming the field. We'll keep in touch. It's only day two of the tournament. We still have 5 days to go.
Oh, yeah.
If you count today, we really got six. So we're going to stay at it. We'll keep covering things. Weather's improving, like you said, and pray for sharks.
Absolutely.
So we're gonna do our best. We got baits out there, surf's a little rough. We're not used to this kind of, I did all my shark fishing on the west coast. It's like a lake over there.
Northport, Florida, just south of Sarasota. I come over here to show these boys how to catch a shark. Got a late start, 11 o'clock, hooked up with Dave.
Woo!
Oh, Megalodon.
Come on, Megalodon.
This is a little behind the scenes in the land-based shark fishing workshop here. We got Zach working his mojo. You want to just introduce your team, Team Rebel, again for us, and just tell us a little bit what you're doing here.
Well, gentlemen, Team Rebel, this is Jeff, this is Pat. We reeled in this bait here because we didn't think it was out far enough. We had a little deployment issue earlier. So just hooking up a 40-pound brake line here. The current and waves are a little stronger than usual. So we're using a little bit larger bait here, double line, so it doesn't fray it off. Always want to get the beauty to cinch down on the corner there so it doesn't slip out. And basically what happens is, he goes out there, deploys it, drops the bait first, then the brick, reel it tight. That's all there is to it.
And this is where Jeff comes in. So for you football fans out there, he's going to be getting in a kayak in the middle of the night. Distance-wise, you'll be 200, 150, something like that?
I think we're going to drop this one relatively short again. Maybe 100 yards, so we'll see. We kind of let Zach determine. He's the leader.
So Zach's in charge. Things are a little scarier than I thought.
But yeah. Oh, yeah.
Damn, son.
I like it.
That
feeling. Heads or tails?
I want tails. We do absolutely anything we can to release every shark alive. There's no reason to be killing these sharks. I mean, the numbers have gone way down from even 4 or 5 years ago. If you're going to harvest a small black tip to eat or something like that, yeah, more power to you. That's within your regulations. But
a trophy fishing just to hang a fish.
You know what? There's no reason you have to kill a trophy fish. Those are the big breeding fish. Those are the ones that are responsible for putting more numbers back into the environment around here. We are already making an impact on younger kids on the piers and beaches who are interested, and they're wowed by the pictures just like we were,
right,
when we were younger, looking like, wow, I really want to do this. I want to be up close to this. We're younger communicating with them, so they buy into it even more. That's why we try to just promote conservation to what we can about it. I mean, I'm not a tree hugger or anything.
No, neither am I, but it's about enjoying the resource.
Exactly. And, I want my kids to be able to do this. We were basically the only two people out there in the app.
Fish off.
You wanna grab that camera, Sean?
Yep. Come on.
Do you really want to hurt me?
I just want
to. You better watch your head, Pat. This fish is in motion.
Are we on there?
I don't know.
Zach, we're getting some nice hits and some solid runs on these baits, and something strange is taking place.
Yeah, I'm not really too sure what's going on here. Not really,
not digging it though.
Not digging it, that's for sure. Definitely better than what's going on up in the nether regions right now with the black tips and the little balls, but, you know, trying to catch the big fish gets a little irritating sometimes when you get strange pickups and stuff like that. I mean, that first one was strange enough how I missed that whole back end of that rig, yeah, period, but.
Well, these are definitely bigger fish we're talking about.
Oh, yeah. Definitely not the target species of the north.
What happened?
Oh my god!
Holy
sh!
Wow.
That's good, Zach.
Man.
Dude,
these are smart sharks.
Look at that, dude.
There's a big section missing there.
Say it's
come
right.
on!
He hit it right in the middle.
You gotta say it's right just me, like that. Man. What the f, man?
That's a good size fish. Look how wide his bite mark is.
Ain't that big.
Still, don't have to be that big.
Yes, it does. We're on blacktip fishing here.
That ain't no blacktip.
Well, probably a cuda, small bluefish, but he yanked pretty hard, so we're all waiting for something to happen here.
If anything, we got a little extra bait, right?
Yep. Pretty sure it's gone right now.
Possibly cobia. Something with hump teeth. Wasn't a cuda.
There was no boating accident, and wasn't Jack the Ripper either.
No, it wasn't. We just don't know. It's a mystery.
Last night, there was probably about six or eight of us out there, and about every 45 minutes, a pack of blacktip were coming in and going down and hitting everybody's rotting away. We had some triples, two or three doubles on. I think there were about, had to be 15 to 17 fish caught, or somewhere, at least a dozen, something like that. But not too big. They were all about right in the 6 foot range. Good time, had a good time. Tackle we got, standard pen 14-0, nothing big there. Big, strong, heavy mono, aluminum butt, custom rod, big old rock for a brick, big old slab of mama's home cooking, nice piece of wire, just a little short. I usually run about a 6 to 8 foot piece of wire going after the big fish.
Is that like a number 19?
Yeah, this is a number 19. This is piano wire. I like to stay away from the stainless so it'll rust out of the shark's mouth if you gotta cut it. So stay away from the stainless. About 500 pound swivel and send her out there.
He's right here.
Who's gonna get him?
talking about your tackle and your technique that you're using here tonight. You're actually using a variety of them.
Well, we got an 80 wide international that we kayaked out right before dark, and it's about 200 yards out, and the bait, you know, it's tied off to the brick with the breakaway, and we got a stingray wing on that one. And then on the 50 wide here, I'm just casting baits out in the trough for black tips. And I can cast pretty decent. I get a 10-foot rod, so it helps. But just got a short leader on this one. It's like a 30-foot leader on the other one. It's a pretty short leader on this one, though. And just circle hooks on both, and that's pretty much it. Not much to it.
Now tonight, you already got one in. Tell us a little bit about that catch.
Well, it was just after the sun went down, and I didn't know if they were going to be in here yet, and I threw it out, and I was about to, I put the rod in the holder for a second, and I took about two steps back, and the rod went off. It dumped a good amount of line off the 50. I got 100 and drags pretty tight, and dumped a good amount of line, and I didn't know if I foul hooked him or what, but when I got it in, it was just a monster tip. Like, you know, I guess the calculated weight was about 150 pounds, so it was a big one.
Perfect is July. Wind's blowing about 5 miles an hour, but this is a little different. So, but I don't know. Somebody's got to do it. So.
Right now we're trying to get the bait out past the breakers, and the strategy is to take it at least 300 yards and hope for a big bull, hammer, or tiger. Blacktip snook.
And on the other side of that 300 yards, we've got a drop off, right?
Yeah, it's a lot deeper out there. We got cow nose ray from the west coast. We caught about 12 of them. We brought them over for the tournament, and big rocks to keep it down so the waves don't wash the bait back to the beach.
As far as the heavy gear here,
it's a 14-0 with 130 mono, full spool 800 yards, 11 foot, 130 to unlimited length.
These are old workhorse reels, man. You can't go wrong with these babies, right?
The old pin forever.
Yeah, that's it.
The old pin forever, guys. That's that hammer, I'm sure. I like the run. Watch out. Watch out. Watch out, guys. Come on, run!
Oh, he dropped.
Willie, he might only took the rock. Leave it out there. He'll come back.
Man, I'm going out.
Get your bait out there. That was a big one.
Yeah, it was.
Guys cast their baits, we watched you kayak your baits. Last night we watched a guy walk into the wash and toss his baits.
Yeah, now we're gonna surf the baits.
Now we're gonna surf the baits now.
Fishing's been slow, but we've got two more days left in this tournament. Bring us up to speed with who's in the lead and how many sharks have been caught.
20 that I got and received from email, and there's five more. And Ashley was on the, when I was on the phone with the guy, he had another one on, so he had to let me go. So that's possibly six more that I'm getting home. And I hear that Mikey up in Jensen has got a bunch. So we're expecting a lot of sharks in the next 2 days. It's gonna calm down and it's gonna break. Someone's gonna. I mean, whatever the standards are right now, it doesn't matter, okay? Because in the next 2 days, someone's gonna break everything, okay? So, I mean, it's either Chris Bishop's in the lead right now with everything. Most sharks, biggest shark, biggest black tip. But you know what? I mean, if he doesn't fish hard in the next 2 days, he's not gonna win. He's got to. He's definitely got to stay consistent, and I think he will. So, you know what? It's gonna be interesting to see. I mean, all it takes is one big fish.
That perfect bite mark right there.
We've lost a lot of the wind, but at the same time, it seems we've lost some of the fishing action too. But that could all change in an instant, am I right?
Absolutely, you know. I seen four right there, like I told you the fellas earlier.
Right before I got in the water.
Right before you got in the water, they swam right in front of me, you know. So there's fish in the area, it's just a matter of when they're going to feed.
We got pictures.
Yeah, I got hit again. It came in, cut the rock off, and spit the bait. Never set the hook, nothing. We ran probably 10 yards and just spit the bait.
Let's check the bite rate, see if we can figure out what it was.
I'm going to say 5-foot black tip or spinner shark.
And this is what is left at this point. You see the perfect bite mark right there. It's about the average size of a bite of a black tip.
Just missed the hook.
7-8 inch wide.
Smart sharks here today, apparently.
He was definitely in the vicinity of 12 foot, and I'm almost positive he was eating a black tip or eating a ray, because after a while I look over and I'm looking after we already dropped the bait, and I see the slick of the blood going north with the current. I see a slick. I said, that's why he's not coming over to eat my bait.
Uh-huh.
He's eating whatever it is he was eating, the black tip. I saw the slick on top of the water, the blood.
Yeah, he was chowing down. It was really great feeding behavior. I managed to catch a little bit of the tail end of it.
It was exciting to see him there.
It was.
Got our hearts pounding.
Watching the 2009 Blacktip Challenge Land-Based Shark Fishing Tournament. Now let's hit the beaches and see who's fishing and who's catching.
Hit down there, caught one. We got one from the boat. They're hitting those as soon as they hit the water. We put a blue runner on that rod, the last three baits. And like that time, before I even got back to shore, that's the only rod I did. I took it out, brought it back to shore, and the rod just started bending over. I couldn't even get to it. So as soon as we're dropping it, they're hitting it. That's the bait to get right now.
So Friday the 13th, and you got any fishing superstitions, for better or for worse, about that?
Nah, Friday the 13th, today's a good day. I mean, must be a good day for fishing. total. 57 fork.
57 fork?
Yeah.
So this thing is like 200.
Girth?
Hold on, we're doing it. Looks like about 30.
Oh!
31. We had a picture jump. It's 3 o'clock, is hammer time, and we're gonna put this kingfish out there. I cut it up so it looks like it can swim. Jimmy, you got the picture? Watch out. I need more.
68.
68. 65. Skinny guy.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Brooks Paxton, ladies and gentlemen.
Just playing with some sharks today. Well, I think we're up to like five now.
For the day?
Got some great aerial footage. Got some great underwater footage. Turning out, Friday the 13th turned out to be a pretty good day out here in the beach. Tom showed up.
Biology in there. Anything can happen, especially with the conditions improving the river.
Absolutely, and especially with the signs that we're seeing. Big sharks and tearing up little sharks and big runs, you know, I mean, just wait. Something big is going to be somewhere.
So many females out here. Tag.
You got the tape?
Yeah, here.
Let's go.
That's 73 total.
60.
Girth.
Oh, that's a fatty, hey?
33.
Check my email, I haven't got any emails yet. So I got a feeling I'm gonna get a lot of last emails at 12 a.m., you know? So
a lot of anglers are still out there actively giving it.
Oh yeah, everybody's going full out right now. You know, because I mean the biggest fish is 155 pounds. It's up for grabs, guys. I mean,
that's right.
You can catch a blacktip right now, it might weigh 160 pounds. Someone gets a fish over a girth of 40, you know, 40 inches and you know its length is around 80 inches. It's a very good shot at breaking 155. You know, and I mean, this is truly gonna be a battle to the end. I mean, somebody could hook up at 11:58, and could bring it in at 2 a.m. and can win the tournament.
Yeah,
it's not over for the Fat Lady Saints.
The 2009 Blacktip Challenge was presented by these fine sponsors.
Welcome to the 2009 Blacktip Challenge. Let's hit the beaches and see who's fishing and who's catching.